Hello, everybody. Thank you for the introduction. Jen actually gave a perfect segue into this talk here, because I will also talk about extravascular hematomas, which is simply a collection of blood outside of blood vessels. And we all know what they look like. They happen all the time, and we know perfectly well what they look like if they are subcutaneous, so it's quite simply a bruise, but they actually happen pretty much everywhere. They can be in muscles, they can be around inside organs, it can be in the abdominal cavity as well as in the brain, as we just heard. Here is an example of a large hematoma inside the muscle, and another large one in the spleen. They're pretty common. They are usually the result of sharp or blunt trauma or surgical procedure. Importantly, as a result of muscle sprain and overuse, not just in professional athletes, but just in recreational athletes. The one important characteristic of them, the important ones, is that they are usually quite large. As Jen mentioned already, they can span centimeters or even tens of centimeters. In case they happen in soft tissue, are they bothersome? Are they a problem? In fact, yes, they are. Especially in the case of muscle, they are very painful. Athletes would be out of the sports fields for weeks on end with lasting damage to the muscle. In case of surgical procedure, there is a risk of infection. Worst-case scenario is the risk of compartment syndrome. This is what happens when the hematoma is large enough to exert pressure on surrounding organs and cut off the circulation, and the organ simply dies, which is, in fact, what happened here in this case. So this is the spleen, and the hematoma takes up a good part of it, and the spleen is losing function. The worst part about it is that there isn't much you can do. All athletes, young and old, are very familiar with this RICE protocol, that rest, immobilization, compression, and elevation. So you just sit there and wait for it to go away. The hematomas will go away. Eventually, they will sort of liquefy themselves, but it will take a long time if they are large. In more critical cases, the clinicians would put in indwelling catheters, but they're relatively inefficient because the hematoma is a jelly. It's gelatinous, and so it doesn't really drain very well. The very last resort that the clinicians really don't like to do is surgical evacuation, which is a major surgical procedure even for soft tissues. They just open it up and scrape out the hematoma. If we could find a rapid way to liquefy the hematoma non-invasively and then aspirate it with a small needle, it would be really useful to interventional radiologists. What we were told by the radiologist we work with is he wants it to be 15 to 20 minutes tops, and he wants to do it with a little handheld transducer, image-guided, to liquefy large volumes of the hematoma. If we do it for a longer time, he's not interested. That was our motivation in this study. We decided to compare a couple of histotripsy methods and see which one works faster here. The cavitation histotripsy, we saw a number of talks today already. I will just remind that it fractionates tissue through formation of cavitation cloud in the case of the shock scattering mechanism. These pulses are short, and pulse repetition frequency is on the order of hundreds of hertz or kilohertz. Another type of histotripsy that we can use is called boiling histotripsy, and it fractionates tissue through repetitive millisecond boiling. Boiling happens within milliseconds because of the nonlinear propagation at the focus and rapid heating at the focus, and the formation of this large boiling bubble and its interaction with the rest of the pulse lyses tissue. The outcome of these two histotripsies is remarkably similar. It's a cavity in tissue filled with subcellular debris. In case of boiling histotripsy, we normally use longer pulses spaced at around a second, so PRF is about a hertz. The duty factor is roughly the same. What do we need for all of our histotripsies? Obviously, for cavitation-induced histotripsy, we need a large peak negative pressure and a shock. for boiling histotripsy, we actually try to avoid this, and we just need a large enough shock to boil in milliseconds. So the experimental arrangement is again very similar to what Jen has just showed. So we used fresh bovine blood poured into molds and allowed to clot as our phantom. And we produced histotripsy lesions in it using a self-fabricated transducer. It was ultrasound guided. And we would translate mechanically the phantom. And after the treatment, we would either drain the liquid debris or cut it open and see what we did. And we used a couple of different transducers and different frequencies here to try to optimize it. Both of the transducers were fabricated in-house and designed by Adam Maxwell. And this technique actually came initially from University of Michigan. It's a very useful technique and produce high instantaneous pressures with low duty factors. These transducers consist of flat piezoelectric elements that are glued to a rapid prototyped plastic lens. And we used two of them. We used a 1 megahertz 7-element array that had a relatively large footprint. But remember, we want something handheld relatively small. And towards that goal, we also used a smaller footprint sector transducer at 1.5 megahertz with pretty similar F numbers. So the F number was roughly one. To reiterate, we used, for boiling histotripsy, we used 10 millisecond pulses at 1 hertz pulse repetition frequency. For cavitation histotripsy, it was sort of a classic shock scattering protocol that we borrowed from University of Michigan group. Was 5-cycle pulses at 1 kilohertz pulse repetition frequency. And these are the focal pressure thresholds derated into our clot phantom that were enough to attain cavitation or boiling histotripsy. And interestingly, at 1.5 megahertz, the threshold for cavitation histotripsy is quite a bit higher than for boiling. And at 1 megahertz, they're actually the same. So that's probably the frequency at which the two histotripsies merge. It's both histotripsy techniques were really could be really well seen on ultrasound. So this is what the boiling histotripsy cloud looks like, and the cavitation histotripsy cloud. These are the residual cavities that are formed by the previous location. So at first, we wanted to investigate the dose dependence of the cavity size on the number of pulses or the duration of exposure at a single location. So we compared the boiling histotripsy and cavitation histotripsy. This is the number of seconds, or for boiling, it's also the number of pulses that we used at each location for 1.5 megahertz and 1 megahertz. And as we see, we don't really need that many pulses for either technique because the lesion size saturates after a certain duration. Cavitation histotripsy lesions at having the same duration are substantially smaller, but they also have a more regular size. So they're sized like an oblong ovals, whereas boiling histotripsy lesions have this funny tadpole shape. So if we quantify the volume for each lesion, we see that actually we don't really need to do more than about 5 seconds, 5 pulses exposure for, let's say, 1 megahertz boiling histotripsy technique, or for that matter, any other. So these are the conclusions that we drew from that. And if we take this rate at for 1 megahertz boiling histotripsy and simply apply 5 pulses at each location consecutively without any phasing or playing with improving the rate, it already gets us 2.8 cubic centimeters per minute, which is quite good already. It gets us into the ballpark of what the radiologists want. Then we decided, great, we'll try to make volumetric lesions and make them merge and try to drain them through the needle. And so we translated mechanically the focus through in a 2 by 2 centimeter grid with a 2 millimeter space between the cavities. And we did this first with the boiling histotripsy at 1.5 megahertz. Then we stuck the needle into that cavity. This is the higher resolution ultrasound image of the resulting clot. And you can see this dark area that was liquefied. So we stuck the needle in here and aspirated about 8 cubic centimeters by the needle. And here's the bisected sample. However, there was a problem that there are these little filaments that protrude from the side of the cavity. And they were obstructing the needle as we're draining it. It's a simple problem, but it was it really bothered the radiologist that we worked with. He said that this is not going to go. He wants some unobstructed aspiration. Then we tried cavitation histotripsy using everything the same. And although it took quite a bit longer, the cavity edges were really smooth. And so the aspiration was a lot easier. So then we decided, well, let's combine the best of the two worlds. We'll do the rough debulking of the clot using boiling histotripsy. And for this particular result, we used a 1 megahertz transducer and spaced the lesions 5 millimeters apart. So this was 2 by 4 centimeters clot. Debulk it initially. And this is what it looked like afterwards. So we still see these little tails that we would like to get rid of. And then in the second step, we will erode these filaments using cavitation histotripsy. And we don't need to wait too much at each spot that way because there are these liquid vortices that attract these little fragments and liquefy them really efficiently and very fast. And that took another 7 minutes. And after that, we aspirated the lysate, and we were able to produce 20 cubic centimeters using a 21 gauge needle. So it's a relatively small needle. So the thrombolysis rate was already 1.3 cubic centimeters per minute. Again, as Jen mentioned, we can play the tricks of phasing, electronic phase steering, and improving the rate. So we also did some staining of the lysate to see what's actually in it. At first, we used smears of the lysate and of normal bovine blood. We're using right Gimsa stain, so which it tells us what's in the blood sample. The fresh bovine blood has lots of RBC, red blood cells, some platelets, a couple neutrophils here. The lyse clot has most of the red blood cells are lysed, so hence the pink background color, but some are still left. We still see some platelets. And we did find some larger clot fragments, but 99% of debris were smaller than 10 microns, so they definitely did not interfere with fine needle aspiration. And we did not find any debris that were larger than 25 microns. So to conclude, we did show that histotripsy-induced liquefaction of large hematomas in soft tissues is certainly possible within clinically relevant time frame and a small footprint transducer. We could combine both boiling and cavitation transducer in cavitation histotripsy in one device to optimize the aspiration. I'd like to point your attention to the fact that all the histotripsy techniques are advantageous in that the B-mode guidance is really excellent. You don't even need to mess with imaging sequences or anything like that. You can clearly see what's going on and where. So in that way, it's very advantageous compared to, let's say, thermal ablation techniques. So thank you. I can take questions now.
Thank you very much.